This is my handcrafted Z80 computer with 128 kilobyte of static RAM and two serial UART interfaces bundled into the so-called Dart chip. This allows to control the computer with a terminal emulation program on a PC, such as PuTTY for example, or even a real computer terminal if you own one. The second interface on the chip enables file exchange with a PC, like I showed in part 3 of this series. And in the previous part I showed how easy it is to connect a PATA-compatible hard drive to a Z80 processor. But to start CPM, we still need the Arduino Mega and the serial drive emulation on a PC, but I want my computer to work independently from that. In this video I gonna show you how this minimalistic Z80 computer can boot the CPM operating system from a CompactFlash card. Stay tuned! To do so, we need a bootloader. The task of a bootloader is to first initialize the hard drive and then load the operating system from there into main memory. So far, an Arduino Mega has taken on this task, but I want the computer to boot on its own without the help of a microcontroller with many times the performance of a Z80. Usually, bootloaders are stored in non-volatile memory such as EEPROMs. In order to get by with as few components as possible and omit one more chip, I came up with the idea of using the previously unused upper half of the 128 kilobyte SRAM chip for the bootloader. But how can the Z80 address the bootloader when it can only address 64K? And the solution is bank switching. For this we have two NOR gates that made the data terminal ready line of the Dart with A15 from the Z80. The result goes to the A16 pin of the RAM chip. So we get a simple bank switching mechanism with four 32K banks. You might now be wondering why the hell the DTR signal is used here, right? Normally this signal is used for synchronizing serial communications. But why bank switching? The reason is simple. DTR can be controlled by software by simply setting or resetting a bit in the Dart register 5. And as it's not needed for serial communication here, it is available for bank switching. And the advantage is that we don't need an additional I/O chip and so have less soldering. After powering the computer on, bank 2 with the bootloader is mapped to address 0. So the bootloader is executed and loads the CPM files into bank 1. After the init routine of the BIOS has finished, bank 0 is mapped into the addressable memory space, while bank 2 with the bootloader goes back to its first place in memory. Now CPM can address bank 0 and bank 1, while the bootloader is safely out of reach, just as if it were on read-only memory. But wait, because we are still using volatile RAM memory, the bootloader would be lost whenever we switch the computer off. A bootloader that has to be loaded into memory every time we power the computer on would be pretty useless.
Now, yes. Oh.
And there we come to the point where the lithium cell comes in. The static RAM chip used here enters a data retention mode when the level on the CS2 pin is lower than 0.2 volt. In this mode, the chip keeps its data as long as the supply voltage is above 1.5 volts. The power consumption is then 300 nanoamps at most. And here's how it's done. The button cell supplies the RAM chip with about 3 volt while the computer is switched off. The two diodes protect the cell from the supply voltage and from being discharged through the other components. With a lithium cell capacity of around 200 milliamps per hour, the IC can hold data for at least 76 years. I guess that's way longer than even a factory new unused battery would last in its blister pack. But there is still one big issue though. Every time when I turn the computer on or off, there are short bounce pulses caused by the on-off switch, what for some reason the RAM chip does not like at all. As a result, some of the memory cells are likely to be overwritten with messy values. This often also affects the bootloader and sometimes makes it unusable. The solution is to wake up the memory chip from retention mode for about a second after power on and also keep the CPU in reset for that time. This is done by an NE555 timer connected to the Z80 reset pin and the RAM's chip select 2 that controls the retention mode. In addition, the bootloader is restored in memory each time when the system boots up. In this way, minor errors that may have occurred when the device was last switched off can be corrected. That means that you only need the Arduino once when you install the bootloader, and then never again. Really? Not really. Under voltage, such as occurs when the capacitor in the power supply unit is discharged when it's switched off, can also mess up the bootloader. Then you have to bring it back to RAM again through the Arduino. But enough of theory now. Let's go ahead and fire that thing up. I plug an USB serial converter into the first port of the Dart and start the terminal emulation. Of all programs that I've tried, PuTTY works the best. I enter the serial port number and baud rate and open the connection. Then I connect the second port to RX0 and TX0 of the Arduino with jumper wires. This connection gives the Z80 computer access to the files on the PC as if they were on a local drive. I call this simple kind of network connection serial disk. Now I plug the Arduino onto the pin header, build and start the loader and click on load CPM. It boots up and loads all necessary system files via the serial connection. If the CPM prompt shows up and we can view all the files on drive A, everything went well. I can now format the CompactFlash card using the Make Disk utility and copy the bootloader and kernel over to the CompactFlash. The card is now ready for use with my Z80 CPM computer. Of course, we want to have some programs on the CompactFlash card. We can copy these over with the pip command now. All in all, it takes more than 2 minutes to copy around 400k of tools and utilities that are part of the original CPM distribution. But I don't want to let you wait too long, so I recorded with time-lapse. Anyway, it's a great opportunity now to click that like button. In this way, we can copy all of our CPM programs to the CompactFlash card. There are 4 partitions with drive letters ranging from C to F and each 16 megabytes in size. This means there is enough space for all CPM programs in the world. Now a word on how files get into the serial drive A. Below the directory with the CPM sources, there is another directory named drive A. And there we have 16 folders numbered from 0 to 15. These now contain the programs and data. For example, there are a couple of games in directory 3. If we enter A3: and press return in the CPM command line, we have access to these games. Now let's copy the files over with pip using the g parameter. CPM knows no directories like DOS or Windows do. However, there are 16 so-called user codes that allow to separate the files so that they don't show up all at once. The G3 in square brackets indicates that we want to copy the files that belong to user 3 into the respective user space on drive C. Let's play a round of Quadris, a game later known as Tetris. Okay, this was the last episode of this series for the time being. If you have any questions, requests or suggestions, write them in the comment section below. Check out my other videos and subscribe to the channel if you want to see more of these. You can activate the bell to always be informed when I publish a new video. If you want to recreate the project, you can find the circuit diagram and the adapted CPM system on GitHub. The link is in the video description. Also consider supporting the channel through Patreon or PayPal. Okay, that's it for now. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Bye.